Good evening. I'm Judy Woodruff on the NewsHour tonight. A logistical nightmare. In Puerto Rico, much needed aid stalled from reaching those desperate for basic supplies. Then, amid airstrikes and cholera outbreaks, the people of Yemen struggle to survive as years of war take a toll on their country's infrastructure. And sexism in Silicon Valley, how one of the first women to take the tech industry to court for discrimination is still fighting for change.
We have more experience, we have more education on average, and we're not getting promoted. And as a group, most of the men got promoted.
All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour. The drive to get more help to Puerto Rico is accelerating tonight, but much of what's already arrived isn't getting to the hurricane victims who need it. John Yang begins our coverage.
Across Puerto Rico, many residents still desperately need food, fuel, and drinking water. But at the Port of San Juan, thousands of cargo containers filled with supplies sit on the docks, unable to get inland to those in need. Why is that aid so close and yet so far? For one thing, shipping company and local officials say both truck drivers and diesel fuel are in short supply, and roads are badly damaged or blocked. After meeting with President Trump this morning, Acting Homeland Security Secretary Elaine Duke said they're working on it.
We have been working on yesterday, principally getting distribution, that last mile, as they call it. To do that, we had to remove debris, we had to restore roads, we had to clear landslides across the island, and we have done things like airdrops in the meantime.
Cell phone service is also hampered by the lack of diesel fuel for generators.
Bueno, el tema de la señal está...
The cell signal is really bad. In the area I live in, which is Morobis, this is a real problem. Lots of people are looking for places, trying to get a signal to speak to family members outside Puerto Rico and in other places across the island.
Today, Mr. Trump directed Duke to temporarily lift long-standing shipping restrictions, known as the Jones Act, in hopes of speeding deliveries of fuel and other supplies.
I did sign a Jones Act waiver this morning that came in yesterday afternoon from the governor of Puerto Rico that is based on national security needs. The president encouraged us, as he has done throughout this hurricane response and the other two also, to lean forward.
Critics like Democratic Congresswoman Nydia Velasquez of New York said the federal response has been inexcusably slow.
This has to happen soon, not weeks from now. Not in late October. This needs to be an immediate priority for Speaker Ryan and the Republican leadership. We need to see action as early as next week.
House Speaker Paul Ryan said FEMA's disaster relief account will get another $6.7 billion by the end of the week. Meanwhile, the Pentagon tapped Army Lieutenant General Jeffrey Buchanan to lead relief efforts. One challenge he'll confront? Eliminating a backlog on the mainland. At air bases in Georgia and South Carolina, utility crews and other contractors have been waiting for days for military flights to Puerto Rico.
We're anxious to go, but we're just waiting. Hurry up and wait. We're trying to get there. I mean, we're anxious to go.
Eager to get to work to try to relieve the suffering of so many fellow Americans. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm John Yang.
We had a closer look at what it's like on the ground in Puerto Rico now. Carmen Juline Cruz is the mayor of the capital city, San Juan. Mayor Carmen Juline Cruz of San Juan, thank you very much for joining us. Tell us what the situation is there right now.
It is a humanitarian crisis. People are desperate for food, for water, for gas, for diesel in order to keep equipment that is necessary for people that are plugged into a respirator or an oxygen tank in order to survive. Our dialysis and cancer patients haven't been able to get most of their treatments on time, which of course is life-threatening. And even though there is aid here, there's reported to be about 3,000 containers of much-needed medical equipment or medical materials, any type of thing that you need. But we were talking here about primary necessities, you know, just a glass of water. It doesn't matter if it's cold. It just matters that you can drink it. I've been getting calls and visits from mayors from towns outside of the metropolitan area telling me that, you know, their people are drinking out of creeks and they're washing their clothes and they're washing themselves on the same creeks that they're drinking and eating and bathing. And so this is a real concern that the aftermath would be even worse because of the health conditions that could be created.
Well, what we've been reading is today is that you do, as you just said, have containers there at the port in San Juan, but you don't have the ability to get a lot of this material to people. What is the holdup?
I don't understand what the holdup is. I do have to tell you that I did get a call this morning from Mr. Bosner at the White House. He did send John Raven, the FEMA regional coordinator, that is in charge, and they have deputized two people from FEMA into San Juan. They are working very closely with a team of our people and a team of logistics experts that the mayor of New York, Mayor Bill de Blasio, and Lisa Mark Viverito have deployed to San Juan. So we will be in a position in the next 24 to 48 hours to start distributing whatever we've already gotten from wonderful mayors like the mayor of Miami, Beach Levine, that came personally yesterday to bring 7,000 pounds of stuff that we need, the mayor of Chicago and the people of the Puerto Rican human rights group in Chicago, Congressman Luis Gutierrez, Congressman Asensio in Florida. So the mayor of Boston has also reached out to see how they can help. So mayors are about helping people because we know we're at the forefront of people's needs, and we're pretty much, you can call us the first line of defense whenever it comes to situations like this. And we have not ever seen anything like this in our lifetime in Puerto Rico. We also need to reinvent and rethink how we are going to rebuild and what are our goals are and our priorities when we do that.
But just very quickly here at the end, you do have enough people to get this material to where it's needed.
Yes, ma'am. We do have enough people, and you know, when there's a will, there's a way.
Mayor Carmen Julene Cruz, the mayor of San Juan, I know we all are wishing you the very best at this very difficult time. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Puerto Rico is not alone in coping with the aftermath of two hurricanes. The U.S. Virgin Islands were also left in ruin. I spoke a short time ago with Governor Kenneth Mapp and began by asking where things stand there.
We're moving out of rescue and into recovery. We've received tremendous provisions and support from our federal partners. We're now talking about and beginning the process of covering and sheltering folks in homes that lost roofs. We've cleared a good bit of debris out of the road system, and we're working on getting the power distribution system up. That's going to be a long haul. We're planning on bringing 400 linemen from the U.S. mainland to help us in that regard, sign those contracts. We are talking and looking at how we're going to begin to open schools. Our children have not been into school for the school year for any imaginable parts, and so we're planning on how we're going to, you know, merge schools and get the children back in school in October. So we're moving out of rescue and into recovery, getting the businesses open, getting the lights on, and doing what we do after we have these damaging hurricanes.
So what would you say your greatest needs are right now?
Infrastructure development, help in terms of building the power systems up, help in getting the road systems back up and functioning. We really have to work with Congress on getting the hospitals rebuilt, getting schools rebuilt. So I'm having those discussions with our federal partners, the White House, and our friends in Congress.
So much of the focus, it seems, in the last days have been on Puerto Rico, larger population on that U.S. territory. Has that affected what you and the Virgin Islands have been able to get done?
I would say no. We feel for our brothers and sisters in Puerto Rico. They've just been really devastated. And you know, we had, after Irma, we had a contingent of their National Guard troops on the island helping us here. And our general escorted them back home and met with the TAG over there. And, you know, whatever we can do to help them, they're just in, it's just, they just really need help. And any quickness in terms of getting the supplies into their communities and to their people is what's really going to make the big difference.
And finally, what about the state of health care, your hospitals, your clinics in the Virgin Islands?
Hospitals are blown out. For all intents and purposes, we're just using covered parts of the emergency room. Mobile hospitals are now being constructed on the front lawns of the main hospitals, and we've evacuated all of the folks that were admitted to the hospitals, people who come, and the doctors say that they require admittance. We simply evac them out. We've evac'd out our patients requiring dialysis services, and those hospitals are going to have to be rebuilt from the ground up.
Well, Governor Kenneth Mapp of the Virgin Islands, I know so many Americans have been thinking about you and everyone there affected by these terrible storms. Thank you very much for talking
with us. Thank you, Judy, so much for spreading the word out for the American citizens, all of us living in these territories. Thank you so much.
In the day's other news, the human wave of Rohingya Muslims fleeing Myanmar has now topped 500,000. That new estimate today from the United Nations. They have crowded into camps in Bangladesh after escaping attacks by the military in majority Buddhist Myanmar. The UN Secretary General warned today that it could get worse still.
The failure to address this systematic violence could result in a spillover into central Rakhine, where an additional 250,000 Muslims could potentially face displacement. It is imperative that UN agencies and our non-governmental partners be granted immediate and safe access to all affected communities.
In Washington today, more than 20 U.S. senators from both parties urged sanctions against Myanmar. In Indonesia, a volcano on the island of Bali has now forced more than 130,000 people to flee. Amid regular tremors, officials say the eruption of Mount Agung is imminent. Tourists are catching any flight available to get off the popular travel destination. Another volcano is rumbling on a tiny island in the Pacific nation of Vanuatu. Officials there have ordered all 11,000 people to leave. China today ordered North Korean-owned businesses within its borders to shut down in accordance with UN sanctions. The Chinese Commerce Ministry said that North Korean companies and joint ventures will have 120 days to comply. The sanctions aim to halt Pyongyang's weapons development by isolating it from trading partners, mainly China. The leader of the Islamic State has apparently been heard from 3 months after Russian officials said that they had killed him in an airstrike in Syria. The militant group released an audio recording today, said to be Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi. He urged his followers to keep waging war in the face of military losses across Iraq and Syria.
Beware of retreat or feeling defeated. Beware of negotiations or surrender. Do not lay down your arms, for Islam rises above everything, and a believer does not humiliate oneself, for God has blessed them with unification and jihad.
The recording also urged ISIS militants to target what it called media centers of the infidels. The World Health Organization is warning that nearly half of all abortions worldwide, some 25 million, are done in unsafe conditions. The UN Health Agency blames limited contraception and safe abortion services in poorer nations. In a statement today, it says there are serious consequences for the health of women and their families. It also says President Trump's renewed ban on U.S. funding for groups that provide abortions will raise the risk. Back in this country, the governor of Illinois, Republican Bruce Rauner, signed a law permitting state health insurance and Medicaid to pay for abortions. He had changed his mind on the issue at least twice before. The new law takes effect immediately. The majority whip in the U.S. House of Representatives, Steve Scalise, returned to work today, more than 3 months after he was shot and critically wounded. The Louisiana Republican entered the House chamber on crutches to thunderous applause. He said he was overwhelmed by the outpouring of support from both sides of the aisle.
Some people might focus on a tragic event and an evil act. To me, all I remember are the thousands of acts of kindness and love and warmth that came out of this. Each and every one of us, we come here and we fight for the things that we believe in. I have passionate beliefs. We are the people's house. This is the place where these ideas are supposed to be debated. And we fight through those issues, but ultimately we come together.
Scalise was wounded in June by a gunman during a congressional baseball practice. Two Capitol Police officers shot the assailant to death and were themselves wounded. President Trump's health secretary, Tom Price, says that he will reimburse the federal government for his costly private travel and change his ways. That follows reports that he's taken at least 26 charter flights since May, costing more than $400,000. Price will pay about $52,000 for his seats on those flights. Yesterday, Mr. Trump said that he's not happy with Price over the flights. And on Wall Street, the Dow Jones Industrial Average gained 40 points to close at 22,381. The NASDAQ rose a fraction of a point, and the S&P 500 added three. Still to come on the NewsHour, Facebook, Twitter, and now Google, the technology Russia used in the 2016 election. Yemen's war-induced humanitarian crisis worsens. Remembering the revolutionary influence of Playboy founder Hugh Hefner, and much more. We've heard a lot this year about Russia and its attempt to use social media to influence the 2016 presidential elections. But new revelations today about the role of social media giants like Facebook and Twitter add to the issue. Hari Srinivasan has our report.
In fact, officials with Twitter met behind closed doors today with staff on the House and Senate intelligence committees about Russian involvement in the election. The New York Times reported that Russia may have used Twitter even more extensively to influence the election, including using automated message accounts, or bots, to spread false information and promote stories about emails by Democratic operatives. It comes after Facebook recently announced it will give congressional investigators some 3,000 political ads purchased by Russian propaganda groups. Facebook co-founder Mark Zuckerberg acknowledged the spread of false information on his platform, saying in a statement, quote, "After the election, I made a comment that I thought the idea that misinformation on Facebook changed the outcome of the election was a crazy idea. Calling that crazy was dismissive, and I regret it. This is too important an issue to be dismissive." Congressman Adam Schiff is a Democrat from California and the ranking member of the House Intelligence Committee, which intends to have a hearing with tech companies soon. Representative Schiff, anything you can say publicly about your conversation with Twitter today?
Yes, they came in and gave a preliminary briefing to our staff, and I view it really as the first of many briefings on what they know now about the extent of Russian use of Twitter as a medium of their active measures campaign. But I think there's a lot yet for them to learn about the use of their own platform, and obviously the American public as well. It'll be, I think, important during our hearing next month with these companies to ask them, you know, how rigorous was their investigation? What are they able to tell us at this point, and what more work needs to be done? Because I think that we only still have scratched the surface in terms of our knowledge of the extent of Russian use of Twitter and Facebook, for that matter.
Do we know if the scale of spending was on the same as Facebook? Twitter announced today that the RT, the Russian media arm, had spent some $274,000 in ads purchased in 2016. But beyond that, did they say anything else?
Well, this was a subject of our discussion as well. They were able to point to that RT advertising. I don't know whether they've identified other advertising. Obviously, that's of keen interest to us. It's one thing when Twitter users get something passed to them by RT, and they can put that in context and say, okay, this is the Russian propaganda position. It's far more pernicious when those tweets are coming and you can't identify the source, or they're misrepresenting the source. I don't think they have a good handle on that yet. I don't think they fully know whether there was paid advertising that was using a pseudonym, and perhaps even more significant, the extent of Russian bots that were used to propagate information in the campaign.
What's your understanding of how significant the influence of these platforms were and how they manipulated the election?
Well, just in the little we know in terms of the use in Facebook of Facebook and Twitter, I think we can tell that it's significant, but we don't really have a sense of the full dimension. If you look at what Facebook and Twitter have revealed already, we know about advertising, we know about the use of these bots, but we don't know much about the downstream consequences of each. That is, the advertising, for example, that Facebook did, those that showed interest in that advertising, what kind of messages were sent to them, and how well coordinated was the Facebook and Twitter campaign in the sense of those that responded on Facebook? Were they then the target of tweets from that same Russian entity in St. Petersburg? So there's a great deal we have yet to learn about this.
To what level have you seen any evidence of collusion between what these Russian troll farms bought on social media, on Twitter and Facebook, and the Trump campaign?
Well, we're obviously bringing people in from the campaign. We're also bringing people from the digital arm of the campaign. We have a great many questions for them. But we're also trying to approach this from the other side in, and that is, can the social media companies tell us more about the targeting of their ads, about the targeting of these tweets? Is it of a level of sophistication that you couldn't perform unless you had the data analytics of the campaign? So we're trying to approach it from both sides. At this point, I don't think we're ready to draw any conclusions.
Are you looking for any sort of overlap in exactly how the political campaign targeted individuals on these platforms and how perhaps the Russians did to rule out or to rule in whether there was any coordination?
Absolutely. We want to know, look, if the campaign was targeting these precincts or this demographic with these specific messages, is that something that's also reflective in what the Russians were doing at the same time? So this is exactly, you know, what we're looking at in terms of trying to prove or disprove whether there was any coordination. I think it's also important, though, that we recognize that on both of these platforms, a big part of what the Russians did was simply turn one American against another. Now, the divisive issues that they chose and the cynical way they did it may have been to the advantage of the Trump campaign, but the broader objective here was to weaken our democracy, to accentuate these divisions. And it's worth all Americans recognizing the Russians view this as a vulnerability. We need to view this as a vulnerability as well.
Representative Schiff, a colleague of yours, Senator Lankford, also said this morning that the groups that are tracking some of these Russian accounts were actually involved actively in conversations about Black Lives Matter, or even just as recently as last weekend, the take a knee or the boycott the NFL hashtags that were trending.
You know, I think that's right in the sense that in the most cynical of ways, the Russians would use these issues, whether it's Black Lives Matter. I haven't seen the examples yet in terms of the NFL, but it wouldn't surprise me at all. This is what they do. They take these very hot issues in the United States. They target them geographically in a way that they're designed to be the most incendiary possible. And in the context of a political campaign, if they can target these particular messages or ads that people that will push them to support one candidate or over the other, all the better.
Finally, Mr. Schiff, are you confident that these technology platforms, these companies, are doing everything that they can to make sure that this doesn't happen again? That is, to sort of target addresses from where this stuff is coming from, to create blacklists, to kind of isolate how this happened and make sure that their platforms aren't abused this way?
I think both of these platforms are really going to have to scale up their response to this and devote a lot more of their resources and investigative effort to ferreting these out, not only as a diagnostic in terms of what happened in the past, but also to protect their users and the public in the future. So at this point, I think it's still very much a work in progress, and both of these companies are going to have to devote a lot more resources to the problem.
All right, Representative Adam Schiff from California, ranking member of the House Intelligence Committee. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Just moments ago, the top Democrat on the Senate Intelligence Committee, Mark Warner, came out and slammed Twitter, calling the company's response inadequate. Warner said that Twitter's presentation was, quote, deeply disappointing, and he said the company showed, quote, again, an enormous lack of understanding about how serious this issue is. Warner said he was angry that Twitter only searched his records based on information already uncovered by Facebook. diplomats from Europe, the Middle East, and the U.S. met in Geneva today to iron out a resolution that would establish an international inquiry into atrocities in Yemen. Saudi Arabia and its allies are aligned with one faction of Yemen's civil war. They stand accused of causing massive civilian casualties amid a punishing bombing campaign with American support. The Saudis deny this, and they say the time is not right for an international probe. Meanwhile, in Yemen, a disastrous humanitarian situation continues to deteriorate. William Brangham has that.
Yemen has been torn apart by a two-year-old civil war as a coalition led by Saudi Arabia fight against Houthi rebels and their allies. Over 10,000 people have died, more than 40,000 have been injured, and over 3 million are malnourished. On top of it all, an outbreak of cholera has killed 2,000 people since late April, and 700,000 people currently are infected. For more on all of this, I'm joined now by Jamie McGoldrick. He's the United Nations Humanitarian Coordinator in Yemen. Welcome to the NewsHour. Can you just give us a snapshot of how the humanitarian situation is in Yemen right now?
Well, after 2.5 years of war, you see things collapsing. The economy's collapsed. The conflict's raging, obviously. And people are facing a number of threats. The most recent one you just mentioned is cholera, where you've got some 700,000 people who've been affected by it and over 2,000 people dead. Those numbers will go up to the end of the year to 850,000. And then it will peter out and it'll disappear for a few months and it'll come back again because the conditions are in place. And the conditions are people can't afford to buy clean water, feed their families properly, and the fact that they have very little resilience anymore. And that's what's causing these outbreaks. And the lack of systems for health to treat the people is one of the big factors.
So is it an infrastructure? Is it water? Is it food? I mean, what is driving cholera in particular?
Well, it's a combination of that. I mean, the water sanitation systems have collapsed. They've been struck by airstrikes or they've been bombed and they no longer function. There's cross-contamination between water supply and, the other parts of its sewage. And at the same time, people who, after 2 years of war, are very weak nutritionally, very weak health-wise. And so it takes up very quickly as a disease and then affects people very quickly, as we saw.
You mentioned this issue of food. I understand that shipments of food and other aid have been hard to get into the country. Is there enough food to feed people who need the food now?
Well, there are two things. I mean, food is getting into the country, but not in the numbers that we need because the ports like Hodeida are being restricted in terms of movements. And bringing food around other parts of the country is quite a challenge. But the other big issue is that people can't afford to buy food. I mean, people's purchasing power has diminished. But 80% of the population are actually less well off than they were 2 years ago. And there's one person out of every four who has no purchasing power. And what that means is that, like, tomorrow there are 7 million people who can't tell you how they'll feed their families tomorrow. That's how desperate the thing is.
You put that as the greatest challenge among the challenges, the many that you face. What is the greatest one?
Well, the greatest challenge is to get media attention and get the world's attention to the suffering of Yemen. I mean, it's been going on for too long now, and the results of it, the numbers are incredulous, where you've got 20 million people out of a population of 27 million who need some sort of assistance, and 10 million of those are in real acute need, starving, not able to feed their families, no access to health care, no access to clean water. And it's just a recipe for further and more desperate, catastrophic humanity situation.
I mean, obviously, it's got to be very difficult, too, with active fighting going on to try to deliver humanitarian aid. Are the combatants getting in the way of you doing your job?
Well, they do in any conflict. I mean, they are there to restrict access and movement, and we find that from all sides who don't understand what their obligations are, which are that we're supposed to have unfettered access to populations in need. But we're often instrumentalized by the parties, and they use us as part of the war effort. And that happens with imports, it happens with moving people around, it happens with getting visas evenly. And so they try to control how we work.
There was a recent UN report that said that the Saudi airstrikes had been largely responsible for the civilian deaths, including the deaths of children. What have you seen on the ground? You live there, you are there all the time. The impact of those Saudi airstrikes on the civilians?
Well, I think like in any conflict, and this one in particular, is that the civilian population who have got no skin in this game, they're the ones who suffer most. And the combination of airstrikes, a combination of bombing and fighting, all sides have been guilty of what is taking place, the international humanitarian law violations. And the protection that should be afforded to civilians and civilian infrastructure has been absent in this crisis.
You said that both sides in this fight are to blame for some of the casualties here, but how would you apportion blame? The civil war versus the Saudi bombing here, as far as the destruction that you've seen?
Well, the physical destruction has mostly been done by the coalition because they've got the aircraft. There's a lot of other destruction taking place because of bombing and shelling and local fighting that takes place as well. There's no side in this crisis is innocent. There's no good guys in this fight. The only people who are in this fight who are suffering are the average citizen of Yemen, who really doesn't have any control over how this turns out.
Have you appealed yourself to the Saudis to say, please be a little more discreet in your bombing campaigns. Try to ease up on the civilian population.
We every time there's an incident, every time we have a problem, we ask all the parties to the conflict to recognize that under the Geneva Conventions, international humanitarian law, they have responsibilities. And the responsibilities are to protect civilians and avoid the sort of damage that takes place to structure and to people's lives. Unfortunately, one of the features of this crisis has been almost a blatant disregard by the parties to their obligations under humanitarian law.
I mean, as you well know, the Saudis have also been very resistant to any investigation into their actions in Yemen. Mm. How is this conflict ever going to come to an end? How are you ever going to really be able to help the people fully there if one of the main belligerents seems to have no constraint on its actions?
Well, I think there are two things. The investigation should happen whenever there's an incident of any kind, regardless of who is alleged to have taken it. And right now, we would call for any investigation into any action on any side that takes place. The way this will stop is for the war to end. There is no military solution to this. There's been no progress made militarily, really, in the last 2.5 years. The only thing is peace. We have to get the political situation back online, because right now, the humanity is suffering because of the lack of politics.
Jamie McGoldrick, thank you very much for being here.
No problem, my pleasure. Thanks a lot for having me.
Stay with us. Coming up on the NewsHour, the woman who sparked a debate about gender discrimination in Silicon Valley. And a journalist opens up about her personal experience with miscarriage. But first, the life and times of the founder of Playboy, Hugh Hefner. Jeffrey Brown has the story.
Well, I remember, with great fondness, the very beginnings of it all. You know, the days in which I held the first issue of the magazine, realized that I was going to be in the business for a while.
The first issue of Playboy was published in 1953, when Hugh Hefner was just 27 and only recently moved out of his parents' house in Chicago. But when it hit the stands, Playboy's 51,000 copies featuring naked photos of Marilyn Monroe sold out. In a 2011 interview with his then-fiancée Crystal Harris by his side, Hefner looked back.
The fact that it would be so successful and that it would not only succeed but also would become such a phenomenon and would, in the 60s, literally change the world, who could possibly imagine that?
With its centerfold and Playmate of the Month, circulation shot up quickly, reaching 7 million by the 1970s. Hefner himself was a walking advertisement for his product. In his signature silk pajamas, smoking his pipe, he fashioned himself and Playboy as the face of sexual liberation. Here in a 1966 interview with William F. Buckley.
What it really comes down to is an attempt to establish what's been called a new morality, and I really think that's what the American, this thing called the American Sexual Revolution is really all about.
Hefner launched his company into movies, TV, and clothing, and opened clubs, resorts, and casinos crammed with Playboy bunnies with rabbit ears and fluffy tails. An expanding empire, but also a rising chorus of critics who saw the Playboy fantasy as exploitative and vulgar. In 1963, then 28-year-old feminist Gloria Steinem briefly worked undercover at the New York Playboy Club and published A Bunny's Tale, an article that described how the women were overworked and underpaid, the atmosphere rampantly sexist and tacky. Feminist blasts never abated, but Hefner was unrepentant.
The suggestion that somehow or other Playboy exploits women is really a political point of view. The truth of the matter is, we celebrate sexuality, and we celebrate the sexuality of the women who appear in the pages of the magazine.
In 1985, Hefner suffered from a mild stroke and turned his empire over to his daughter, Christy. Still, he remained editor-in-chief of Playboy. Just last year, he handed over creative control to his son, Cooper. In the internet era, readership fell dramatically. Hefner at one point turned to reality TV with the show The Girls Next Door, focused on the adventures of his three young blonde girlfriends who lived with him at the Los Angeles Playboy mansion.
I think that a best life is one where one pursues one's own personal dreams.
In 2012, at age 85, Hefner married his third wife, Crystal Harris. She was 60 years his junior. In addition to Crystal, Hefner is survived by his four children from previous marriages. Hugh Hefner died yesterday at the Playboy Mansion in Los Angeles. He was 91. And we take a closer look at Hefner's complicated legacy with Amanda Marcotte. She writes about politics, feminism, and culture for Salon.com. And Todd Gitlin, professor of journalism and sociology at Columbia University. His numerous books include The 60s, Years of Hope, Days of Rage. He joins us via Skype. And Todd Gitlin, Hugh Hefner begins as someone claiming to push against the conformity and puritanism of the America of the 50s. And it worked, right? Give us a little bit of that background.
Well, he was the great anti-Puritan. He made sex for men respectable. That is to say, it was no longer, or really a kind of pornography. The magazines that preceded Playboy were kind of trashy looking. They were printed on crummy paper. You always had the feeling that the ink was rubbing off on you. Sort of something to read furtively. And they had no great literary pretension. They were full of stories about hunting and war. And then suddenly here was slick, smooth, airbrushed, high color, Playboy that it sort of attached an idea of women as playmates to a way of life. The way of life was you're a bachelor, you have your own pad, you have a good record player, you have a nice sports car, you have soft jazz and sex.
But Amanda, this was always sex as commodity, right? I mean, selling the idea of sexual freedom, but always as a brand, the Playboy logo. It's a commercial adventure. What was he selling?
I mean, he was selling, like Todd said, a lifestyle, and it was very much a male lifestyle. It was not really, women were seen as another accessory, like the car, like the record player. They weren't really kind of seen as full partners in the sexual revolution, and it was really just one more object to buy. And, you know, unfortunately, to the end, Hefner was treating women in his own life that way.
Todd, the old joke was about Playboy was people would say, I'm reading it for the articles, but it really did have lots of important interviews and great writers working for it.
Yeah, it did. He paid lots of money for writers. He had a huge circulation, and I think he must have been serious about trying to convey the idea that his idea about sexuality was somehow harmonious with or of a piece with the lifestyle. So you're a playboy and you're reading Isaac Bashevis Singer, and that's all part of the same thing. You're not, you know, some dumb cluck, you know, reading, you know, crummy hunting, fishing stories. You're an advanced citizen, you, Mr. You lucky man, and you get to read the greats. Yeah. You get to interview all the people you're interested in.
But Amanda, I mean, we start off talking about him starting against this idea of conformity, but then clearly running into another kind of cultural phenomenon of the time, feminism.
Yeah, he was in conflict with feminists from the beginning, and I think it's a little bit unfortunate because I think that created this sense that feminists were against the sexual revolution. They weren't. They just wanted women to be included as equals and as full human beings and not treated as objects. And I don't know if Hefner ever really completely understood that criticism. He'd always seemed to just bristle against it instead of really listen to it.
I mean, the charge, though, I mean, obviously, the sexism, this idea of privilege that Todd has been talking about, that's what came at him all the time.
Yeah, and I mean, I think, you know, he leaned into it, if we're going to be honest. The Playboy Mansion was like an icon of his privilege, his notion of himself as a sophisticated man, and he would have these huge parties where he would let his friends enjoy food and drink and drugs and the beautiful pool and the women, and it was all sort of held out as one piece.
Well, Todd Gitlin, even if I think decades ago, he already appeared to many people as a kind of anachronism. He turned to reality TV at one point, but he just went on.
Yeah, and the fact that his empire was actually crumbling, and he was sort of outdone by raunchier, you know, more vile publications like Hustler, and then eventually by the whole sea of pornography that was available everywhere. So he was actually less of a figure, but he sort of, I think, basked in his sort of glory as the founding lech, the founding keeper of the harem, so that at one point, a certain president of the United States in an earlier incarnation brought some of his people from The Apprentice to the Playboy Mansion and said to Hefner, "I can't tell which are your girls or which are mine," which I think tells you a lot about both men.
Well, Amanda, just in our last minute, when you think about that legacy and you think about what Todd was just talking about, how the internet sort of brought a kind of sex to our sort of every moment of anybody's life, if they want it, where does that leave Hugh Hefner's legacy?
I mean, I think it leaves it mixed. I think you can't deny that he played a huge role in the mainstreaming of porn and sexual talk in our culture. On the other hand, I think he is an anachronism, and he will mostly be forgotten in a world where our sexual culture just has very little to do with the way Playboy was conducted.
All right, Amanda Marcotte of Salon, Todd Gitlin, thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And let's turn to a different conversation on questions of sexism in tech, finance, and Silicon Valley. Ellen Powell became a cause celeb in 2012 after she filed a gender discrimination lawsuit against her employer, the powerful venture capital firm Kleiner Perkins. Powell had been a junior partner and claimed that her bosses did not promote her because of her gender and retaliated against her for complaining. She asked for $16 million in damages in a trial, but lost, and her personal reputation was damaged along the way. Still, her case served as a wake-up call. She has a new book about it and the aftermath titled Reset. Our economics correspondent Paul Solomon sat down with Ellen Powell, part of his weekly series, Making Sense.
Ellen Powell, welcome.
Thank you for having me.
From your biography, you do not seem like the person who would sue Kleiner Perkins, or for that matter, pretty much anyone.
It's not my nature. I think the lawsuit was part of a mission to call attention to this problem. So I had tried so many other ways beforehand. I'm not doing that much press. I'm an introvert. This is hard for me, but it's like, kind of now it's going to go on air and all these people calling attention, seeing me on the street and recognizing me.
You don't want that?
I don't want that. It's not my personality and it makes me uncomfortable. But this is a culture that has pervasive problems, and seeing the extent of it, we need to do a whole reset.
Reset is the title of Powell's book, and with its claim of gender discrimination in Silicon Valley, it's become part of an increasingly polarized debate. Just in the last few months, charges of sexual discrimination and harassment have brought down the CEOs of Uber and the online lending startup Social Finance, spurring a backlash. A front-page article in this Sunday's New York Times featured Silicon Valley men alleging discrimination. Powell is a Princeton grad with degrees from Harvard Law and Harvard Business School, jobs in Silicon Valley since 1998, including a stint at venture capital firm Kleiner Perkins that triggered the gender bias lawsuit.
What was the percentage of women in venture capital when you were there?
I believe it was about 6%.
And what's it now?
I think it's gone down. I think it's gone down to maybe 5%. And, you know, less than 1% are Black or Latinx.
Do you think that you were sort of suppressing feelings you were having at the time, or the sense you were getting that there was systemic discrimination against you as a woman, perhaps you as a minority?
There were a lot of, like, 1,000 cuts in little small things that would make it very hard for women to be successful. So women were asked to take notes at meetings, and men were not. Women were asked to babysit. Women were asked to do some of the menial tasks of organizing events and planning conferences, but the men were not. So when it came time to invest, which was the work that you would get recognized and promoted for,
women and compensated for.
And compensated for. It was much harder for women to be taken seriously, and it was harder to get investments through, and it was harder to be successful. And it was also possible for men to take away investments that women were working on if they looked good, and to dump investments that weren't doing so well on the women when they didn't want to work on them anymore.
Now, this sounded strikingly familiar. Listen to Maureen Sherry describing Wall Street gender bias when she was a trader.
Accounts not being given equitably, that's really one way. Or an account being taken away when you felt it wasn't something that you deserved.
And the atmosphere wasn't exactly congenial for a woman.
When I had come back from my maternity leave, I was still nursing and kept a breast pump under my desk. One trader would notice and he would start making a mooing sound, and, you know, sometimes other herd members would join in.
Actually mooing?
Yes, mooing.
Her problem, Pau claims, is that the young men went west.
Frat boy culture came in around 2008 when people stopped going to Wall Street and the people who wanted to make big money fast wanted to be the next Mark Zuckerberg, and they all came out to Silicon Valley instead.
So you're at Kleiner Perkins. You're making a lot of money there, right?
Yeah, more than I could spend.
So what's happening there that's upsetting you?
I was getting blocked. I wasn't being invited to meetings. One of the women at the firm also actually mapped out investments for the women and investments for the men, and showed that the women's investments were doing significantly better. We have more experience, we have more education on average, and we're not getting promoted. And as a group, most of the men got promoted.
And you weren't getting promoted because?
Because we were women. And there was some kind of belief that the men were better despite all of the results and the records.
There's actually research that shows that women are better investors, that they're more risk aware.
But despite that, says former banker Sally Krawcheck, who now runs a mutual fund that invests in female-focused firms, men are better self-promoters.
If it were just about intelligence or effort, we would have much more diverse teams. My experience has been that the gentlemen are more likely to come and ask for the promotion, and that the women are less likely to do so.
They were more assertive and they did things exactly the right way, while we were, you know, too aggressive or not aggressive enough, we were too loud or we were too quiet or we were too competitive, we weren't team players. And you know, it was this endless slew of impossible things to fulfill.
When you confronted that reality, did you think, look, I'm in the wrong place, this is the wrong world for me?
I actually tried to quit in 2007. I said, this culture is not, you know, it's not my culture. And they told me they wanted to change the culture, that, you know, the things that I was bringing up were things that they did not want to be. It wasn't until I really saw, like, I cannot succeed, or any other woman in the firm, that was really the catalyst for me litigating.
So you felt it was your duty to sue?
Yeah, or? I would say that. I felt if I didn't do it, then who would do it? So I sued for sexual discrimination and retaliation.
So what happened?
Oh, you're gonna take me to the dark days. They hired a crisis communications firm that launched a campaign around that I was a poor performer, that my case had no merit.
That you don't get along well with other people.
Right.
And the verdict?
I lost on both counts.
Why?
I think people weren't ready to believe that tech was this really biased and unfair culture.
Or that Pau, who had turned down $1 million settlement offer, had been unfairly treated. Taking the role of devil's advocate, I asked if she could have played along, and if so, how?
Would you have become more of a sports buff? It sounds ridiculous.
But, I mean, those are the things I would have had to do. It was to become one of the guys.
Yeah, but if I'm thinking of myself now as one of these guys, okay?
Yeah.
Much younger, sort of not reflective, making a lot of money. And if you're there and you're not playing along, you're making me a little uncomfortable, maybe.
Well, I think if playing along means, you know, participating in sexist and racist jokes, that expectation has to change. It can't be, on the women to, or, you know, the people of color or the older people to try to make everything better. And I think now that, you know, this year with all these people coming out and with the press and the public being so much more receptive to their stories and being able to take them at face value instead of going through the same process I went through, or, oh, you're not a perfect victim, oh, you are kind of crazy, oh, you're a fraud, oh, you know, you shouldn't have done this, oh, why did you do that? Like, all of that has kind of dissipated as people see, wow, this is a huge problem.
Ellen Powell, thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
Now to another in our brief but spectacular series, where we ask people to describe their passions. Tonight, we hear from Ariel Levy about grief and motherhood. She's a staff writer at The New Yorker and author of the book, The Rules Do Not Apply.
When I was 38, I took a reporting assignment in Mongolia, in Ulaanbaatar, and it was gonna be like a big adventure. I mean, you don't get much more exotic than Outer Mongolia. And it was the last adventure like that I was gonna have for a long time because I was 5 months pregnant. The doctors I talked to said it's fine to fly until your third trimester, off you go. But the second night I was in Mongolia, I went into labor in my hotel room and I gave birth in the bathroom at my hotel. And for 10 minutes I was somebody's mother. And then the baby died before the ambulance got there. And that was that. That was that. It was like a switch had flipped inside me, and I'd experienced, however briefly, I'd experienced maternal love. And I couldn't get that switch to flip back. So I felt like a mother. And, you know, a flip and switch in my body too, when I was making milk to feed this baby who wasn't there. It was almost like an identity crisis. It was like, I know I'm a mother, but I sound crazy if I say it because I have no child. While the particulars of my situation are unusual, like I have yet to meet another woman who's like, I too lost a baby in a hotel in Mongolia. Like, that's weird. But miscarriage is extremely common. I was doing this reading in the Bay Area and this woman said, I have three children who are alive. I lost four babies and I'm 77 years old and I miss every one of them. I just had always thought that if you were dogged and strategic and you had tenacity, you could get what you wanted. But being dogged and strategic and tenacious has not convinced my body to make a child. And that's not up to me. I had this idea in my head since I was little that being a writer, like a woman who was a writer, was the kind of woman who is free to do whatever she chooses. No one's really free to do whatever she chooses except Mother Nature. Just having a situation where your body is out of your control, it's a preview of death. It's a preview of mortality. And it's certainly been something I've thought about more since this happened, but counterintuitively or not, with less fear. I feel better about it. My name is Ariel Levy, and this is my brief but spectacular take on Mother Nature.
Powerful story. On the NewsHour online right now, the author of the controversial young adult novel, 13 Reasons Why, weighs in on censorship and writing about challenging issues for teens during this Banned Books Week. That and more is on our website, pbs.org/newshour. And tune in later tonight on Charlie Rose, Iran's Foreign Minister Javad Zarif, on the future of his country's nuclear deal with world powers. And before we go, a sad follow-up to Mike Saray's piece last night about the echoes of Vietnam. We featured two young men, brothers born years after the war, who suffered terrible disabilities, likely caused by the lingering effects of Agent Orange, the toxic defoliant spread by the United States in Vietnam. The young men and their family have been supported for years by Larry Vetter, the Army veteran in the story. Larry was told late last night after our broadcast that one of the young men, Nagia La,
died yesterday morning. He was just 22 years old. And tomorrow here on the NewsHour, America Addicted, we kick off a new series on the nation's crippling opioid epidemic.
We're talking about a substance that is poison. It's manufactured death.
Knowing that that next bag is going to kill you, it doesn't matter.
I planned on dying. That was my plan.
You have any needles on you?
We've got 10,000 heroin addicts here.
I've gained family trust back. I've gained my girlfriend back. It feels great.
That's tomorrow and all next week on the NewsHour. I'm Judy Woodruff. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you and good night.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by